Well, even outside of As Above, you guys have done Quarantine, the Poughkeepsie Tapes. I don't know if you guys have seen that. Amazing film. Again, I think that was the first time y'all dropped on my radar. And it's like, these guys seem messed up. I like that. That's a real fun one. You guys did Devil.
So just a little background before we kind of dive into this. You guys are from Minnesota, originally. I know a little bit of your backstory, but for those who don't, how did you end up in Los Angeles torturing all of us with your visions?
Well, we started off... Is this on?
Yeah.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, we started off writing, like, really as kids. Like, you know, I'd start just writing stuff at night when we were in high school, and then bringing it across to his room, because we went to this military school. It wasn't cool. Yeah, I was like writing poetry and all sorts of, you know, it wasn't cool there. So, but I could show Drew anything, and then he'd start critiquing, and we'd start shifting things around, and that's sort of how we started.
That's true. And Minnesota's incredibly cold, as you probably know. So it's very long winters. You got to do something to entertain yourself. This was back, you know, pre-internet. The video games weren't very good back then. So we did a lot of, you know, in-house creation of stories and things like
back
that.
Back when you got your entertainment from here.
Exactly.
Yeah.
You had to really go for it.
Yeah, Minnesota sort of breeds weirdos.
It does.
You know, you got the Coen brothers, Bob Dylan, Terry Gilliam. Like, it's all these, like, there's a lot of weirdos that sort of, I think just those months indoors just sort of drive you nuts. Yeah.
Well, even outside of As Above, you guys have done Quarantine, the Poughkeepsie Tapes. I don't know if you guys have seen that. Amazing film. Again, I think that was the first time y'all dropped on my radar. And it's like, these guys seem messed up. I like that. That's a real fun one. And you guys did Devil. So obviously, I think you guys have a pretty clear sort of vision on point of view. Point of view, I think, as we all know. How many of you guys are filmmakers, content creators, producers? Yes.
Nice.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Great. You guys have a very clear vision of your point of view, and you're telling a lot of these stories with found footage. So kind of going into that, is that sort of a device that you know going into a project that you're going to be using, or does sort of the material lend itself to that?
Well, I think one of our like big fascinations is perspective. You know, like even in Devil, which, you know, it's not
right.
You know, found footage or anything, like, you know, people kept asking, like, how are you going to keep the elevator interesting in that? And what we did was, you know, for every scene, we tried to pick a character whose scene it was, and then sort of show a close-up of them and then what they were seeing. And in doing that, it sort of roots you in that character's point of view, and you're not getting information they're not getting. And I don't know, there's something, you know, we just did another film called The Coup that we're just finishing right now. And, you know, it's the same thing. It's a family caught in a crisis. You're not getting any news, any information that they don't see. And, you know, we don't subtitle things if they're not understanding what's being said.
It's experiential in the same way that a found footage movie is, but, you know, it's not bound by the same, you know, restraints that a found footage movie is. So we've always liked that style. We did Poughkeepsie Tapes, and we shoot that in 2005.
Mm-hmm.
And that was kind of a, you know, faux documentary about found footage. And that, you know, back then, if you were making a movie like that, it was really important that you made it, you know, try to be real almost, or you know, we embraced the nonfiction or the fictional nature of it, but you had to really go for kind of a nonfiction feel. But now it feels like found footage, you can really kind of embrace a fictional nature. Audiences don't need to believe it's actually real, they just want it to feel real and the performances to feel real. And it's really opened up, I think, in a lot of ways.
Mm-hmm. For sure. Well, I mean, well, speaking of realism, you guys shot As Above, So Below in the real catacombs beneath Paris.
We did.
Bold. Yes, give it up for that. So while you have these characters running around and experiencing all this claustrophobia and stuff, how many crew did you have just directly behind also dodging, you know, low ceilings and bones?
We had maybe 10 people sort of running. You know, the walls were so thick, like, no walkies worked through them. No, obviously no cell phones, no walkies. We kept saying we need some, like, Kenyan marathon runner to just, like, run the tunnels, go up and get shit, and bring it back down, you know, because, I mean, it was just,
like,
you forget around. Something up in the truck, it was like, ah, you know,
a half an hour
turnaround, and, you know, our wireless monitor to watch the takes was, like, it wouldn't go through the walls or anything, so we had to run behind the actors anytime they were running down the corridors, and we'd, like, you know, we'd use it for light. We couldn't have our headlamps on, otherwise, you know, you'd see us in the background. So we'd just put our arms up like this and run full sprint, like, through these corridors. And, you know, we all took divots in our heads. And and there's people with neck braces on at the end of the shoot, you know. Over, you get the whiplash from, like, hitting your head and like that. Yeah, I mean, it was...
Hopefully I had a good insurance.
Yeah. They made us get insurance.
It was in France. Just lock in any hospital. We'll take care of you.
You guys did As Above in Paris, or underneath Paris, and The Coup you shot in Thailand. Before I'd seen this film, I was like, these guys are just globetrotting. Yeah, we'll write a movie in Thailand. And then I saw this, like, they were not experiencing Paris.
No. Everyone's like, oh, life must be rough. Summer in Paris. It's like, well, five stories underground. It's actually freezing down there. It was like, you know, 30, 40 degrees. So.
Wow.
Yeah, so it was a dark summer in Paris.
Yeah.
But we do it for the art.
But Paris is still amazing. It was still, yeah. Can't complain still.
It's a great place to shoot. And, you know, part of it, shooting found footage, you know, it was partially like, you know, function too. You know, like you couldn't shoot standard, like setting up lights and, you know, like you just couldn't do it in the normal way. So, you know, we had the actors light it themselves, which is dangerous, but it worked, you know, it feels real. We had the actors shoot like that last scene when they're all standing around the you know, the hole right before jumping in, like, you know, Scarlett is actually, the camera she's holding is the only light source. And you know, that was the point at which, you know, the DP, like, I kept saying, like, push it harder, and that was the scene. I was like, are you sure? Like, that's it? Like, this is like a key scene. He's like, come on, you know, now you're, you know, this is radical. You know, this French TV. This is radical. And I was like, all right, you know, and it looks, you know, it looks real. It looks really, really amazing. And sort of embracing some of those imperfections is...
Yeah, quarantine, we were much more, you know, precise. And it was our first studio film. I think we were a lot more, you know, nervous and we're a lot more precise about where the camera was. We had the F-23, which was just a hog, you know, and you know, on this one, we're like, let's embrace the accidental nature of the lighting, and the, you know, let's really just see where the, you know, where the lighting lands, where the camera lands, and you know, our DP, we had him do something different every take, so every actor was always ready for a close up or always, you know, in it. They could never take a, you know, a single take off because they might be, it might be their close up on that take, and that was, you know, fun for them too. It was like an action sport.
Yeah, that brings me to an editing question, of which we'll get to more in a little bit. But whenever you're doing this found footage stuff, I mean, I think all of us, if we've been in an edit room and trying to stitch stuff together, you always kind of have that moment where you're like, I don't have that shot. Oops.
Oh, yeah.
Yes.
How many times did that happen? Because clearly, I mean, if you're really just, you're just running and gunning and making it happen in the edit bay, I mean, you're stitching this stuff together and, like, you obviously don't have, like, your shot reverse. How much of a challenge is that to just try to, you know, I mean, you're trying to effectively tell this story, but you don't have coverage of these things.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, you know, I like to tell people, like, for me, the darkest time in filmmaking is the first 2 weeks of editorial. You know, because you're watching the dailies, you're like, I'm rocking this shit, you know, and then you get into editorial, and the first 2 weeks, you're like, ah, oh, I just blew it, you know. And then it's just putting the screws to it, you know, you go through this depressing zone, and then you say, you know, Elliot, our editor, you're like, Elliot, you gotta fix this. You gotta save us.
Well, it's amazing how much you can shape, you know, a movie in editorial, and how much you can shape an actor's performance in editorial too. It really can go a long way. I mean, you can, you know, we had one actor that came off initial cuts was, you know, kind of a dark performance, a good performance, but dark. And we literally just, you know, over the course of 4 or 5 weeks, turned it into like a really, you know, upbeat, you know, totally different tone, completely, just based on. Yeah.
At times, cutting him, like, syllable by syllable.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, we really, you know, got in there.
But, yeah, editorial is kind of an amazing process, and you have to have a lot of patience, but it's, I really think so much of a movie is made in post.
Absolutely. Well, I think, I don't speak for everyone, but we all just watched a pretty amazing horror film. There's something that has, something about the horror genre that just has this gravitational pull, I think, for audiences and filmmakers. Like, obviously, we're in the midst of our Halloween season here at the space. There's a lot of really cool horror and Halloween stuff being shot right now. What is it for you guys that draws you into horror? The first project you made was a comedy, right?
Yeah, sure, yeah.
They're
not
too different.
No,
horror
no,
and comedy.
No. Setting up a surprise and then, you know, switching it at the last second. And that's, you know, that's comedy, that's horror. And I really think everything you need to know as a filmmaker... you know, the horror, the bones of horror, like, you know, it's suspense, it's timing, it's, and I think once you have that, and, you know, pathos, like, you have to care about the characters to really care, you know, like, you have to really not want them to die to make it matter, really, you know.
And you can do really surreal, strange things in horror, like, this movie's so, you know, bizarre, and, like, in a non-horror film, you're, you know, it would be an art film almost or something, you know, there's a certain level of artistry that you can attack in a horror film that, I don't know, that you couldn't in other films. We love using comedy actors too. That's a thing we go back to all the time. We, you know, actors that are really skilled in comedy, we feel can do just about anything.
Yeah, because they're not too worried about, like, you know, they'll cry with, like, snot all over their face, and, like, they don't care. You know, they're used to putting on funny wigs and being silly. They don't care. Whereas, you know, a lot of times. You know, a lot of actors get scared of looking, you know, like, they become too self-conscious sometimes, and comedy actors are awesome, you know. Yeah.
All right, so let's get into a bit more of the editing for suspense portion of our evening. You guys said that you're currently in post for The Coup.
Yep.
On all of your projects, just in general, how involved in the edit process are you?
Extremely,
yeah. We're there all day, every day.
Yeah, the first two movies, the comedy and then the Poughkeepsie Tapes, we edited, and then the Poughkeepsie Tapes, at the very tail end, we did, like, a little reshoot right before premiering at Tribeca, and we brought in this editor, Elliot Greenberg, who has done everything since, and he's like our third brother, so the three of us sit there and, like, argue, you know, like an old three-way married couple, I guess.
Three's a good number, though. It's just the two of us, we might have some stalemates that we can't get over. It's good to have a third, and that. And he's a great cutter, but he's a really good perspective in terms of performance and in terms of pacing. And, so yeah, we hash it out. We're there. We're extremely involved in edit.
And generally, like, if Drew has a problem with something, or Elliot does, or I do, like, we all listen to each other, and, you know, if you know, like, Drew is very conscious of hand acting. Like, if someone has a coffee cup that doesn't have coffee in it, you know, Drew, like, it drives Drew crazy.
Props,
you know, so Drew is all about the hands and feet and wardrobe. I'm all about the hair and...
He's a hair guy, yeah.
So Drew, you look at the bottom part of the frame, you just have the top.
Yes, exactly.
If you both do your jobs, you got a great movie.
I swear, on As Above, every take, you know, Purdy, the lead actress, John would come up and touch up her hair every single day.
Yeah.
It was good, though, because she had
but it didn't
hair.
Distract you guys.
No.
Like, yeah, like, it did the same with Owen Wilson.
Same thing Owen Wilson in Thailand, yeah.
There was that one flyaway. It just took me out of the
movie. There's seriously takes you can't use because there's some hair issue that you just can't handle. From that.
Nope. You gotta protect your actors.
Post-production's a fun world.
Well, I think we actually have some clips from some of you guys' other work. This is a clip from Devil. I think we'd just like to show this and just have you guys sort of walk us through the thought process.
Cool.
More on the editorial side, what you're sort of trying to accomplish and how Post sort of helped bring that to life.
Okay, this is in Devil, five people get trapped in an elevator together. And we wanted to give the feeling that they were predestined to be in the space. And so this is... I guess this is less of an editing thing. This is more blocking, more, you know, conceptually, like, you know, it was almost, I'd say, edited in pre-production where, you know, we went and walked this floor, this walk over and over and over in pre-pro. And we actually moved one of the walls so they wouldn't have to walk too deep because we're like, oh my God, this guy has to walk forever to get over here. So we're like, okay, we put up a big giant fake wall, and they're like, no, we can't afford it. And we're like, but we need it for the shot. You know, we traded other things. We traded a crane day or two.
We want to keep it in a water too, so that's why we couldn't, you know, just jump ahead through the whole lobby. I was going to say, the one editorial thing I'll mention, though, is when we end up in the elevator, one thing we decided to do in pre-production was to make every scene in the elevator one character's scene. So, you know, that was part of the challenge of this movie, is how do you make every elevator scene, and there's a lot over the course of the movie, how do you make it continue to feel new and different? And so every character, we, you know, every scene we pick one character and it's their scene, and we come in and we shoot them on a single, and then we cut to their point of view of the others in the elevator. So at the end of this clip, you'll see we kind of come in right to the salesman played by Jeffrey Rand, and it's his scene in the elevator on this one.
And I gotta say too, as far as, like, if you shoot perspective, if you keep it subjective and shoot perspectives, it really limits the coverage you do, and I find that, like, you know, that helps you get through your days a lot quicker, you know, just from a practical standpoint. But it you know, in keeping it finite, like, it keeps the actors from getting beat down if you're not doing, like, close up wide, you know, medium, like, eyeline, you know. If you're not doing all that stuff, like, if you really keep it precise and sort of minimal, sometimes you find yourself in post going, like, I should have done, you know, one more whatever. But I don't know, there's a freedom to that that can be really nice.
Yeah, right on. Let's start it up.
So they told us that you can't do a steady cam looking straight up, but we found a way. So then we had the composer do these low sounds of each one of these guys to give you a sense of, like, he's important. So he crosses you through. And then that wall straight ahead is fake. We move, you know, to move that in.
Lost.
Otherwise, there's four of these things. It's just too many.
Hey, lady, you got something?
Oh, where's Ramsey? He knows me.
Ramsey's out sick. You got me. And that means you got to sign in.
I mean, do I look like such a threat?
Don't blame me. They got procedures.
Keep dreaming, dog.
You got to cover the sign in. Some lawyers on 39 need this right away.
Well, you're not taking the stairs again.
Well, what else am I going to do to stay in shape?
To 39? Just get on the damn elevator.
So then here we cut this cut. We're now on stage.
Can squeeze in?
No.
And we wanted to have this, you know, right here, this one-er. So we, you know, our Steadicam operator was in a giant green leotard, which was endlessly fun.
6'6".
6'6", this huge guy, like, dressed like a giant green Smurf, which was awesome. And
we initially had the one-er come all the way in and connect, but we... It was just too long. 42. We got to the toilet, like, you know, just like a minute too long.
Let's see, this I can do.
You hold that?
I'm sorry.
Just to get that feeling of, like, an ominous presence slowly coming in.
Don't mention it.
Into the elevator with them.
Then Erick kind of established the style of, you know, picking whose character scene it is. And so this is his one view, and then back to his single.
It just helps to make it really personal, and you feel like you're him for a moment. Being a pervert.
pretty reasonable pervert.
Yeah. Well, fairness.
This is not good.
But for that, we actually built... We built this elevator, and you know, we wanted the, like, lines in the wood to be vertical, because that gives you a sense of, you know, usually they do the wood lines are horizontal because it gives you a sense of grounding, but the vertical lines give you a sense of, like, you know, like, unease, like you don't have a footing. And we actually built one of these elevators. We got this big thing that would allow us to drop it, like, you know, a couple feet to really give that. And then we realized, like, we're gonna hurt someone if we do that. So so we just said, okay, let's try one. We just shake everything and add a sound, and they did a really good job. Really, really sold it.
Probably didn't need the real bounce. Yeah.
Yeah.
We're kidding.
Yeah, but if you can get it, like,
yeah.
I mean, a scene like that really goes to show that the editing of a piece does not just necessarily happen in post production. Mm-hmm. Having these long Steadicam shots, how just, like, immaculate word storyboards. I mean, this, it has to be more than just note cards. Like, you're editing this thing before you shoot it, basically, right?
Yeah.
This one was heavily storyboarded.
Yeah. We boarded this, maybe the whole I think we did pretty much the whole movie.
We were making the movie with M. Night Shyamalan, too, who was in Philadelphia, and of course, you know, he wanted him, you know, he was not able to come up to Toronto, and he was a producer on it, and he wanted to see, you know, kind of what the movie was going to look like throughout, so that was one way that we could keep him in Philadelphia.
Yeah, and the use of just those, like, little low tones, every time you introduce a new character, like, I just really love that steady cam shot, and, like, just little reminders to the audience, or even just nudges, since it's the first time we're meeting them, just like you said, this character is important, this
yeah.
character is important. How much is that, especially for suspense and for horror, like, music plays such a great role, but, like you said, this is not found footage, it's something like As Above, or Quarantine,
mm-hmm.
you don't kind of have the luxury of adding
That's
your
true.
Little low drones and tones. How do you sort
That's
of
true.
Approach stuff like that? And found footage, you just find ways to kind of make it diegetic, non-diegetic? Oh, film school was so long ago.
Oh, yeah.
Real sounds.
Real sounds.
We want
yeah.
real sounds.
You know, we like to say with Quarantine, we did no score, and we kept saying we want to score it with sound effects. And, you know, when they come into the building, they hear, like, what's that? What is that? And it's like, oh, the heater is broken. Or, you know, like, we do a number of things to justify, like, all kinds of weird creaks and sounds and things. And as it goes, it gets more and more kind of hellish in Quarantine. And we have helicopters going around and, you know, sirens in the distance and, you know, things like that that sort of amp it up. But As Above, I mean, the soundscape on that is, those guys just rocked it. It's... You know, it's everything from the rock creaking. We tried to always frame in the ceiling because there's something about having, you know, five stories of rock over your head that's really unnerving. And yes, you guys made it serious. And then to hear the little cracks and stuff just keeps your unconscious aware of that. And
As Above, it was, you know, it has a supernatural element, so it allowed us to, you know, bring in some kind of musical elements, or the choir, and bring that back in.
And the horns. Like low
yeah.
bassy horns.
So we could add some, you know, some kind of that deep bass to it. But the Quarantine, we just went naked. That one was a lot harder. We had to really work the sound design to make sure we weren't, you know, losing any tension based on no score.
And it seems like you guys also put a lot of emphasis on the pacing of your projects. I mean, a lot of things kind of fall into the trap, sort of like, it's a very constant pace throughout. And it seems like, especially Quarantine and As Above, like, you maybe start at 15 miles an hour, but by the end of the film, you're at 115 miles an hour. And it's just relentless. How much of that is formed in post-production, or how much of that, I mean, obviously it's planned before. You write scripts before you shoot them. But, I mean, just like kind of putting the pedal to the metal on that, how far do you think is too far? Were there versions of the cut where you're like, it's too bananas? Or is it always just kind of like that sweet spot?
I think you have to put it in front of an audience until you really know where it's too slow, where it's too fast. I mean, you think you know in post, and you think you know even before you shoot the movie, and then inevitably, once you put it in front of an audience, it, you know, there's certain zones where you don't even need to hear the feedback yet. You can just feel it in the room, like, this section is too slow. We gotta pick it up. I mean, it's really just sitting with people and watching it really makes a huge difference.
Yeah, we like to say that first audience you show it to is like, it's kind of your sacrifice, your sacrificial audience. You have to put, like, you know, 50 people in a room just to see it yourself and go, oh God, that's, you know, we have 30 minutes up top we don't need, you know.
It always gets shorter, you know. It's you know, we're always about 20 minutes shorter at the end of the day than we were in the first cut. And you know, we like to joke our director's cut would be, we'd be the only filmmakers that would have a shorter director's cut.
And we just always stop.
We can't stop.
Like, oh, there's 2 seconds there we can lose. And you know, but part of it, it has to register. It has to, you know, the beats have to be clear and delineated. Otherwise, it, you know, I think it's too quick when it just becomes a mishmash of stuff. You know, it has to, like, this happens, then this happens, then this happens. But within that, the time it takes someone to, I don't know, pick something up you can get around, or the time that, you know, little things like that, and that adds, you know, it can really add to the pace of it. But yeah, we go through literally second by second, and you know, Drew Elliott and I, and the three of us, like, we'll usually do our first test screening, then we you know, get depressed, and then we, like, get together, we go, like, literally in 5 second chunks through the entire movie and say, what about this shot? Can we lose a couple frames off this? Could we? And we just pick at it until it feels like it has a really good momentum.
And you've got, I think there's moments too where you really need to know when to allow yourself to slow down. We have a scene in The Coup where, you know, all this crazy shit's happening, and, you know, in the lobby of the hotel, people are getting shot, and Owen Wilson gets on an elevator, and we ride the elevator up with him, like, a full 8 floors till he gets to, you know, the room where his family is, and it's this, you know, you want the elevator to speed up, you're in full sprint mode, and we thought for sure when we cut the movie that, you know, when we sell it to a distributor, they're going to make us, you know, nip out most of that elevator ride, and we just dug our heels in on it, and everybody loves that scene. It's just this, like, it's so tense because it won't speed up, and everything else around it is moving 100 miles an hour, but then you just put the brakes on completely, and that really works, too.
Yeah, I think we have another clip, if we can get that queued up. This guy is also from Devil. Is there any setup for this one, or do you just want to dive in?
I'd say no real setup necessary, other than this one is the young woman's scene. We named all our characters, you know, by the security guard, the salesman, the young woman, the old woman, and the mechanic, because they don't know each other, they don't have names. So this one's the young woman scene. The lights have gone off once already, and she got cut in the back. So we know when the lights are going off that something bad could happen.
Keep him away from me.
Geniuses have done a bang-up job so far.
It's like, I remember an editorial where, like, you know, we had like 3 seconds of black, and they were like, let's make it crazy, let's make it like 15 seconds of black and see, you know, let's see what the sound designer can do. And then we just kept sending it back, and you know, so much of horror is what you don't see. And I think that's one of the things found footage, like, part of the reason that, you know, that kind of subgenre works is you can justify not seeing so much. And so, you know, the darkness, you know, displaying the darkness, playing the just letting the audience sit in the dark in the theater. We had a lot of fun playing with that.
We did. This is the only PG-13 movie we've made, and we actually had sound effects kickback from the MPAA during the darkness, like a gurgling sound. I'd never heard of that before. The kicking back sound design.
Oh yeah, and they kept kicking it back. It's too intense. Yeah. I was like, God, there's nothing like.
We're leaving it up to your imagination. You're too intense.
Exactly. Yeah. Thank you.
Yeah. There's always, I mean, horror especially, like, you can have so much fun with sound and, like, playing those little moments where, like, obviously your imagination is probably way worse than anything any of us could put on screen. Well, maybe not you guys. I lost my train of thought. I just remembered a scene from As Above that freaked me the fuck out. I think we have another clip. We're going to go into Quarantine now, which is, if you guys haven't seen, what's wrong with you? This thing is bananas. There's no B, that was just me calling y'all out. Any setup for this guy?
This is sort of the first attack. They've been called to this this apartment building. She's doing a kind of a fluff piece on the, or like kind of a reality show fluff piece kind of thing on the fire department. And we actually modeled, there's a 9/11 doc of these two French firefighting brothers, or two French
documentary
filmmakers who are following firefighters on 9/11 and ended up in the towers. And I mean,
just by chance.
Just by chance,
we're doing a documentary on the first unit to respond.
And it's such a gnarly doc, and so we took a lot of that stuff, and like we studied that, and we tried to emulate as much as we could of that kind of feeling of, like, you know, I don't know what it is like to follow firefighters around.
And this was, I will say too, from an editorial standpoint, we shot this entire sequence, and actually quite a bit before and after all of the oneer. So we shot like a 10-minute oneer, and then we ended up hiding cuts in post-production. quite a few cuts in the sequence, so it ends up being a combination of many takes. But for blocking purposes, and we wanted, you know, it to play as a oneer and to shoot it as a oneer.
Yeah, we wanted the film to feel like, you know, there's no cuts except when the camera turns off, and we really wanted to, like, and now, you know, now in found footage they just do the little nips everywhere, and that's part of the vernacular now, and so that's it's a lot easier to do than doing a. But we were doing 5 or 6 minute long oneers pretty much every day. And we told the studio, like, don't stress if we haven't, like, shot anything by noon or by lunch.
They loved that.
They stress every day.
And we told them that, and then every day at lunch, they'd be like, why haven't you shot anything? We're like, we're rehearsing. We'll get it, you know.
We
and
kept getting our days, but yeah.
We had one 12-page day, which is great. Like, it never happens in studio. Like,
that's
yeah.
Sound footage, you can do that.
Yeah.
You can.
Not found footage. Unless it's talking. People talking.
Yeah.
Or something.
Well, let's take a look.
She must have any thoughts.
I'm going to do an intro, okay?
Yeah, you're good.
Okay. We're standing outside an elderly woman's apartment. Neighbors heard screams and called 911. The fire department's about to begin the rescue process. Police say that she lives alone. She's not very social.
I need to get back.
Ma'am, we're the police.
So the sounds of
we're
these
here to help you.
Kind of infected people, we blended their, you know, vocals with what was it, pigs and monkeys and baboons and like.
No need to worry,
like,
Mrs. Espinosa. We're here to help you.
Okay, ma'am.
It's okay.
It's all right.
Everything's gonna be fine.
This movie was a crash course for us on how to.
Right,
ma'am.
It's okay,
ma'am.
Oh, no.
Jesus.
Okay?
What in there?
Ma'am, we're the police. We're here to help you.
Ma'am, it's all right. Is there anybody else in the apartment with you? Any more animals?
It's going to be okay, ma'am.
All right. It's okay. All right? It's all right.
Mrs. Espinosa, it's all going to be all right.
Part of the trick of quarantine,
I just need you to calm down, okay?
If you have too long a chance to stare at me, because I'll be at stop speed and staring pretty quick. So, you know, I mean, like, having the shadows. Camera has to move back.
All right, let's just clear space. Danny, get everybody out of here.
Back it up, please.
It's
really hurting. We are moving him. We are waiting for the ambulance.
All right, see the ambulance here. We have to get him downstairs.
All right, come on.
Down the door.
Okay. Come on, guys.
That was all about the light moving. Yeah, like her banging the light.
Let's go.
Keeps it sort of strobe light. One of the action things that with his head on purpose
that
take every day.
This is my favorite hidden cut right here.
Right
there. That's it.
Human
tape,
everything.
Yeah,
you know you can hide
them.
Everybody knows you can hide
them
in wetpants.
So if you pause here for 1 second, I'll tell you a little story here. I was our plan was to have them set this bloody guy down right here at the bottom of the stairs, and this is our. Day one we shot in the firehouse. This was day one on stage, and so this is like our first studio movie. We had done the Poughkeepsie tapes and the Dry Spell, but those were really small movies. And then this was like we built this whole apartment complex, and you know, like it was like a studio thing, and it was terrifying. And so day one they were gonna put this guy right there, And they're like, I wouldn't put him here. That's right in the way. I'd put him over there. And then all the actors agreed with each other. And suddenly they're moving the guy over to this other spot. And then the producers, like, you know, all these producers started swarming me, like, wait, I thought you were there, you know. And it was such a clusterfuck. Like, I got eaten alive this day. And it was like, I remember talking to Drew in the parking lot, like, I don't know if I want to do this the rest of my life, you know. And, like, after, like, 12 years of struggling to get to that moment, I was like, oh, I hurt so bad.
We had a very demoralized director that day. Day one was like, you know, all joy. Yeah. And then day two was
Day one we shot 12 pages. Day two was like, I quit. You know, and Drew went to all the producers and was like, okay, from now on, like, you all go to me. You talk to me. And Drew sort of built a bubble around me, which I deeply appreciate.
Well, usually you're, you know, when dealing with actors, you're dealing with two or something in any given scene, two or three or four, but here you had about 10 in a really echoey building. They all wanted, you know, attention every take because we were shooting these long, you know, oneers that were very intentionally blocked out, and it was just this, like, it was just chaos between takes, and it was
awful. And I had little video villages. I had them set up in, like, there'd be like a hole in the wall, and I'd have one set up there and one set up there. So I'd do one or two takes at this one, and then the producers would find me, and then I'd do one or two up there. Like, it was just the most horrible day. And the actors just ate me alive, you know. And they're like, I don't believe my motivation. I'd be over there. And so day two, I was like, okay, from now on, I had plans, you know, of the stage. I had the art department give me plans of the stage, and I said, okay, I'm gonna do this like a football coach. I'm like. And then next day I was like, okay, you cross over there and you do this. And then you do, like, and I had it so buttoned on, no one had a chance to. I came in the next day, like, just like a freight train. Thank God they started listening.
We shot this movie chronologically, too, which is unusual. You don't usually get to do that. And because it was all in one location, and, you know, it made sense to do it that way. And I kept reminding John early, like, don't worry, like, by day five, we start killing them off. We'll get fewer and fewer.
Yeah. In the herd. You order in which you kill them off, depending on who was like, you know, I'm not supposed to be in the back, but what if I just
get rewrite. Right.
Yeah, but, you know, part of it, like, I learned a valuable thing, too. If you don't give, you, like, even if it's just, like, this much between takes, like, you know, even if it's that much, like, you got to check in with every actor between every take, or they start creating problems, you know, right? And it's just not, you know, everyone needs validation, like, we all do, you know, like.
And a lot of actors don't seem like they need it, but you, I mean, it just, like you said, it just, it, you should, you need to check in with them, every actor, every take, it's true.
Yeah, it's funny, I was actually, you know, before the coup, we hadn't worked with, like, big stars until the coup, which was, like, Pierce Brosnan and Owen Wilson and like you know, stars. And my brother-in-law had done The Perks of Being a Wallflower, so he'd worked with a couple stars, and I took him out to lunch. I was like, okay, you know, what do you do? And he was like, he said, well, you know, everyone says actors are like children, but who doesn't love children? They're temperamental and they throw tantrums, and, you know, and I don't know, there's something about that really, I don't know, I there's a, you know, if you see it like that, it's, I don't know, there's a, they're like, I don't know, their heart is on their sleeve, and they're, you know, they're like the sweetest people, but,
and they've got the hardest job, you know, they really do.
Yeah, they do. They're the man in the arena. They're the ones who, you know, people are like, ah, you know, his, you know, he looks stupid. You know, like, you know, we can sort of hide behind them a little bit.
No, it's true. It's, you know, we say that with all love for any actors in the room. It's the hardest job. It really is. And they have to really bear it all every take. We have to, you know, we can hide behind the camera a little bit, and we have to stand behind our work, but it's not us up there. You know, it's a tough job. Yep.
All right, so I think we have one last clip from Quarantine.
Cued up, ready to go.
Level set up. Coming up to, or you can play it, I think we can set it up as we go.
Going with you, wait.
This elevator we want to keep as a water, but we have the real actor, Dennis O'Hare, coming out, and then you'll notice when he ducks back into the elevator, he slips, you won't see it, but we call it a Texas switch, he slips through a trap door, and a subman dressed as he comes out, and takes
the back
door. The door locked behind me.
So that's the real actor. He comes out, ducks back, goes for a trap door, and the guy rests his leg. And I kept thinking it was him. I was like, wait, you got it! And he kept fooling me. I thought that was funny, you know.
Hold the door, we need to hold the door.
one of our sort of running gags is the Gypsy Tapes. For those of you seeing it, Cheryl Dempsey is my wife, or Stacey Spassky, who plays Cheryl Dempsey, and so we have since killed her in every film. And As Above, we didn't. There just wasn't. You just couldn't populate it because you're down underground.
But we killed her twice in the theater.
Yeah, so we kill her in every movie. She's kind of our Kenny, we like to say.
So you're gonna see her awesome that scene coming up here.
We said, like, in all the found footage we've seen, like, we've never seen someone use the lens of the camera as a device.
We wanted to, give the camera purpose here, where it's not just like, just film it so people will know what happened. We wanted to give it, the light serves a function when the lights go off, and then here we establish it as a weapon, something that can, this guy can use to protect himself.
Everyone's been evacuated.
What?
Why would he broadcast that? Why would he do that?
What the fuck is going on?
What happened?
How was that?
Oh, Jesus Christ, Jesus Christ.
What was that?
Lesson too, like she was doing such a good job, and we had to take, and I was like, oh, let's just do one more for safety. And I forget, it's a stunt, it's not a huge stunt, like, I mean, it looks like the face man, but like pushing her back onto the couch, but then she like twisted her arm or something when she got pushed back on the couch, and she started crying, like, was trying to hide the fact that she was crying, and I just, like, it was the most horrible, like oh, I didn't need another take, like. When doing stunts, like, I mean, she didn't hurt herself. It was just more, like, embarrassment, but I felt like, she knows how to take a fall.
We didn't. It's true, though. Even if it's a light stunt, just, like, going on the couch. If you don't need it, you don't need it. I think we learned a lot in quarantine. But I gotta say, my favorite still from the set photography on this movie is his wife, Stacy. Somebody's like, hey, we had her face cast in various stages of crushing, but we have a great photo of her like making out with her, like, her own crushed face. Awesome.
How many in the impacts, how many different takes or stitches of cuts is in there? Is
we
that
had,
all just kind
of
one?
We had three levels of face crush. One of the biggest visual effects we did was actually, we realized, like, in all the face bashing, like, his shoes, like,
his shoe untied.
Untied and retied like five times. So Drew was like, that drove Drew crazy. So we had to get visual effects to tie his shoes. just to get him to stop. I was like, no one will ever see it. And, I mean, there's actually moments where, the camera guy, and we did this in As Above too, the camera guy and the actor playing the camera guy would dress in the exact same clothes. There's moments in quarantine where the camera looks down and you see he has like three feet. And it's sort of awesome. So, and then in France, we had this French DP who's, he's French and he's fancy. And then to dress him like our character Benji, it was delightful every day. Like, he'd show up like dressed to the nines and then have to change into like very American
jeans
and tennis shoes. And it was deflating. It was just funny every day.
You took all the French out of
it. Yes,
we
did.
Just eat the French out of it.
We did.
Well, I have one last question before I turn it over to you guys. And this is more, we're entered the YouTube space, I mean, YouTube is generally known, I don't particularly love this phrase, but the Wild West of filmmaking. Anybody now has a cell phone with a camera in it that shoots HD, and you got iMovie on your laptop. So theoretically, everyone can be a filmmaker now.
Which is awesome. Great.
It's great, but there's still something to help differentiate you from the herd. You know, I mean, just because everyone can do it doesn't mean everyone should, but if everyone is attempting to, what steps can we all take to just sort of help us separate ourselves from the rest of the pack?
I'd say, you know, learning to write, you know, more than anything else. Like, over and over, we say, you know, we couldn't get the jobs we can write our way into. You know, over and over, it's like, you know, I believe, you know, like, the script of the coup, we couldn't have competed as filmmakers to get that job.
That's true.
But we could write that, and, you know, a number of projects we've come on to were, you know, that we haven't, you know, written, were sort of a mess, and, you know, we were able to come in and shape it and give it some form, and that's, you know, I remember in film school, you know, people, they're like, I was always off writing, and that was sort of my, you know, that was my thing, and people would be like, why are you spending all this time writing? Like, you know, you just buy scripts, it doesn't really work that way, you know. Like, by the time it trickles down to us, you know, it's been passed by, you know, a lot of people, and you know, it's usually broken if it gets to us.
I'd also say too, when you're doing, you know, our first movie was $30,000, which, you know, back then, this is before, you know, equipment was so affordable and everything too. So $30,000 was nothing, and then, you know, making a film like that, you have to spend a lot of time in post because you're doing everything yourself and you can't afford professionals to, you know, to add to your team. And so I think a lot of people doing, you know, really kind of more DIY filmmaking today, the technology is all there. The cameras are here. You can get access to a Red Epic. You can get access to great equipment, but you really do need to spend the time in post, you know, and you really do need to just keep editing and keep layering and sound design and find a great composer. And you can get composers for really reasonable numbers now. Like, everything's come down. Visual effects has come way down. It's, you know, but you need to spend the time. You need to, it's fun to shoot. It's not always fun to spend a year in post-production, you know, but that.
Yeah, what did we spend? Three on the dry spell?
2 years in post.
Movie, you know, I guarantee no one in this room has ever seen, you know. Yeah, we spent two and a half years on our $30,000 movie in post. And I literally was living in one room. We worked on the script on one side of the room, and I slept in the middle of the room, and then I had the editor, you know, like Apple on the other side of the room, and just, you know, I spent years just, you know, just hammering at that, you know, day after day, and we submitted it to all the festivals and got turned down by all of them. We retitled it, recut it, and then submitted, you know, the next year again, and thankfully we started getting some festival play that year.
Yeah, Slam Dance took us that year, and that was like our first break. But then Poughkeepsie Tapes, we were cutting that for a year and a half too. I mean, it's,
yeah.
You can't really shortcut that process when you don't have a lot of money and don't have, you know, a team of 50.
Yeah.
But
if you just don't stop, you know, if you're just unrelenting, you just don't stop, eventually they just have to let you in.
And listen to the feedback. The hardest thing, you know, one of the things it took some getting used to is really putting in front of, you know, a room this size and letting 50, 75 people see the work you've done, and then just having them fill out cards and listening to it and seeing, you know, if you're seeing 10 people mention one thing, like, it's an issue.
It's a problem.
You gotta address it.
Mm-hmm. Did not be precious. Like, yeah. You know, we try to, with our scripts, you know, for every 100-page script, we've probably written 200 pages we've cut, you know, by the time we even shoot it. And then once we shoot it, then, I mean, we try to egg each other on to just stay unrelenting and just, you know, keep rethinking everything and, you know, until you can't.
Mm-hmm. Well, all right, guys. Well, it's time to turn it over to you. Just raise your hands if you guys have any questions.
And one thing we do a lot of with the scares themselves, like, if, you know, if something, like, if I'm gonna, like, grab Drew suddenly, we'll cut these frames out so things just sort of snap, you know, like it snaps into motion. You just nip a couple frames off the top, and that sort of, you know, that can add a little, like, extra, you know, give the audience a little jolt too.
Yeah, speed ramps and frame removal, those are all fun tricks. But a lot of times it's, you know, we don't totally know until we're in post, and we're the first test audience of where exactly what frame we put the scare at, and we'll try it, you know, every frame for like 15 frames in a row to see what works best, and it's always kind of a work in progress.
Yeah, to try and stay very sensitive to your own material and see what scares you, you know, because that usually translates, you know.
Watch too many horror films. There you go.
Anybody else?
This movie. How long take to put the whole production in Paris?
First movie?
Yeah.
As above,
all this one.
Yeah, we were there for 3 months, and we
4 months.
4 months, 4 months, and we shot for six weeks.
30 days. 30 days. Shoot.
Drew's more precise. I'm a little more like all over the place.
It was a 6 week prep, 6 week shoot.
We shot 5 weeks underground.
Yeah.
And then 1 week on like exteriors and stages.
And what was your budget?
It was $6 million.
$6 million?
Yeah, mm-hmm. It was pretty small, all things considered. But it was the fastest thing we've ever worked on. We were supposed to make the coup last fall, the year, you know, fall of 2012.
Mm-hmm.
And we had met with Legendary about doing this, and they said, you know, is there any way we could make the coup go away and do this now? And we said, no, we're all set to go in 2 weeks, you know. We've already got our locations and our actors are ready to go, and lo and behold, the financing, you know, the night before our flight, the financing imploded and the whole thing just unraveled. So we called Thomas Dull.
I guess we're available for the next year.
We called Thomas the next morning and said, how quickly can we get to Paris? You know, we'll write it now and immediately. And from that moment to delivering a director's cut was about 8 months.
Wow.
So we wrote it, prepped it, shot it, cut it, and delivered it in 8 months.
And then
got on a plane to Thailand.
Thank you.
Definitely a speed record.
It was a crazy year. So we did two movies this last year. We did this. We spent 4 months in Paris and then came back for 7 weeks, did a cut of it, and then we went to Thailand.
And it wasn't
that, and then we did post on both at the same time. And so it's pretty crazy, really pretty exciting year, you know.
It was fun doing post on too. It's fun to, you know, spend one day on one movie and the next day on the next, and keeps it fresh.
Yeah.
So a curious fact, the quarantine, how you guys make that dog drool?
He had some drool, but we wanted more, so we touched up in visual effects a little bit.
Yeah.
But he did have some foam. They put some sort of like Alka-Seltzer in his mouth.
Yeah, we did that. What was that? Not Epsom salt. There was
I forget the name of it.
Yeah, that foamy stuff. You know, the special effects makeup guys were like, "Oh, this will." Yeah. What's it? Yeah, it's basically that, and it was really salty, and it was just like, so we had all these actors drooling all over the place. It was really fun, but the dog, you couldn't go too far with the dog on that. So
we enhanced it.
We enhanced that visual effects.
Yeah, we got space.
This isn't about editing. So there's Poughkeepsie tapes. Is that set in Poughkeepsie, New York?
It is.
It is.
Okay, I still live there. That's
oh, nice.
Sorry, enough to keep talking. Did you film there?
We filmed 3 days of establishing shots there. We didn't bring any actors there. We shot it here in LA.
Well,
yeah.
What made you pick that? I'm sorry, just trying to be nice.
Just the name.
Nobody's been working on it so many times in the course of my life.
When we came up with the idea,
we
were like sitting at lunch, and I started like rapid fire like ideas at Drew, like, what if we did this? What if we did this? And Drew's like, no, you know. And then I was like, what if we did like a fake documentary on a serial killer's home movies?
I was like, what did you say?
Drew was like, whoa, let's, you know, like, we were comedy guys at that point. Drew was like, dude, drop everything, let's do that. And I was like, we could call it the Poughkeepsie tapes, you know. And we had never been, neither of us had ever been, or knew nothing about Poughkeepsie. And thank God.
You're
just
shitting on where I live.
No, it was sight unseen. It was sight unseen. We had no impression.
Well, then everyone thought it was about Kendall Francois, who was a real serial killer in Poughkeepsie, who murdered a bunch of prostitutes.
And then he buried all these dead people under dirty laundry in their house.
Yeah,
and
he was
living with his family.
He was living with his parents,
that's
never
nasty.
Yeah, that's
yeah,
a crazy
so,
story.
But
that's
we're
immortalizing it.
Well, one of my friends who started when we were working on the movie, I was like, how's Ypsilanti tapes going? The only other city that you'd mistake for Poughkeepsie. Yeah, I don't know. Sorry.
Yeah.
Better
than Ohio. Hey, guys. Well, first of all, thank you for being here with us.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
My name is Gabriel Sosa. I'm an actor, so thank you guys for giving us, you know, the proper praise between takes. Just a little bit of confidence, even if we seem like we don't need it. My question to you guys is, you know, it seems like you guys have sort of trailed it as your own path. You did, you know, the Poughkeepsie tapes, and you sort of have found, you know, niche with the found footage stuff, and you sort of reinvented that. And I just wanted to ask you guys, what do you see in your horizon? What are some of the projects that you guys want to work on? Do you want to keep perfecting the style that we've seen sort of consistently from Quarantine to As Above, So Below? Or do you guys want to completely flip it and you know, do more comedic stuff again? Where do you guys see yourselves, you know, going in the next couple of years, or as you're going to have more and more opportunities?
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, I think, you know, frankly, I think right now we're sort of reaching a moment where we're feeling like we want to pivot a little. And, you know, we just did a, you know, The Coup is a thriller. It's like, you know, it's not a horror film. And, you know, it's like this family caught in this horrible situation, and there's little kids and, you know, husband and wife, and there's all this drama to really dig in on. And we had a real chance to dig in on a couple moments that, like, get people choked up, and, like, and that was so fun to not, you know, doing horror has been amazing, and, you know, I'm sure we'll come back to that, you know, sort of, you know, forever, but there's something in not being bound by, like, oh, we gotta make sure we have a scare somewhere in here. Like, to not be bound by that, you know, it was sort of freeing to be like, okay, we can sort of shape this how we want. And so I can see us doing more kind of dramatic thriller.
Yeah, there's still a real common thread there with a family in a crisis where, you know, family is somewhere, something happens, and it's crisis mode. So in a way, there's still a common thread with The Coup as previous movies, but... like John said, there's something really fun about the thriller genre, the not being in found footage. We love found footage movies. It's fun. They're fun to make. They really are. But, you know, The Coup was a lot of fun to make, too. And that that feels like a jumping off point to, you know, other movies. That was probably the hardest movie, including our early ones. It was probably the hardest movie to finance. We were working on it for 7 years, unlike As Above. It's the anti-As Above pace.
Yeah.
It fell apart 5 times. And we just wouldn't let it go, and we finally made it for, you know, less than half of what we were originally going to make it for, and that was a real exercise in persistence and
keeping the actor keeping, like, our financing would fall apart again, and we'd be like, please stick with us, and Owen would be like, okay, cool, and Pierce would drop out,
yeah.
And then we'd be like, you gotta do a Pierce, you know, we'd slowly bring him back on.
Yeah. I was like, call me when you have the money, okay. He was just like, see ya. Yeah, we had to talk Pierce back into the movie 9 times, but they love the script, and they're all really happy they did it now. And I don't know, that movie, we were in Thailand, we had no other producers there. We were just on our own making, you know, a movie with these, you know, big actors. It was really, I don't know, felt like a much, even though it was, you know, same budget range as Quarantine and Devil, it felt a lot bigger, and it felt like a new big step for us.
Is that, yeah, that budget level in Thailand is like,
yeah,
you know, we had 3,000 extras. And, I mean, we went crazy. It was awesome. Like, we had, like,
helicopter
wars, and, you know, like, it was,
we burned a building down, but that wasn't,
yeah, accidentally.
Accidentally. Yeah. But it didn't hold production. We just kept shooting the next day. So, yeah, Thailand's
thank
awesome.
Thank you guys.
Yeah,
absolutely. Thank you.
Pass the mic back to you, that gray hoodie there. We have time for one more question, so this is it.
My name's Steven.
Hey, Steven.
Being here as well. I'm also a filmmaker. I wanted to ask you, in terms of all the satanic intricacy, how much of it was from scripture or books you found, or, you know, like the man in the hood in the chair? Are you the type where it's like, oh, let's put a crazy guy, or did you find that somewhere? Because sometimes I'm like, oh, where'd you get that? And they say, oh, just thought it'd be cool. So
yeah.
I was very impressed with the level of detail of all of it evil, and it
thank
wasn't
you.
So it wasn't on the morbid horror movie, oh, this is satanic type deal. It was like brilliant.
Well, thank you very much
that.
Yeah, we, you know, one of the you know, for the hooded guy, like, you know, we sort of, this, you know, this project more than anything else, we were like, okay, this, it's moving so fast, we have to sort of stay intuitive, we have to see what it wants to do and what it wants to tell us, and we didn't have a chance to storyboard the whole thing like we would normally, and so it gave us a more improvisational kind of manner to shooting stuff, which we then actually took to The Coup, even though we had storyboarded The Coup, we're like, let's, you know, adapt some of that, But like the hooded figures, for example, we went into this one of the location scouts is, you know, it's five stories underground, and it turns out this space was used for cloistered monks, 500 years ago, and they still had some of the monk like outfits down there, and there was one that was sort of like behind a wall, and so as you pass it, you'd see it out of the corner of your eye, and you'd be like, ah, fuck, you know, and everyone
every
would do that. Everyone, like, I'm sure that's why they had it there, because like, they did that. And then as we went to the museum that had Flamel's tombstone, and they had all this like display of all these funeral rite things, and it had all these same monks there too, and we just kept seeing that as we were sort of going down the rabbit hole, and we did alchemy tours of Paris. We did, you know, we really tried to really get to know this world really well, and you know, and
yeah, the Flamel stuff we really, you know, researched the hell out of and really tried to keep that very accurate to the myth of Nicolas Flamel. The satanic stuff we kind of, like John said, we kind of let it come to us a little bit and really kind of try to figure out what it wanted to be and what the space told us to do. And
yeah, and we didn't want to do monsters. We didn't want to do like, you know. Yeah.
We decided we didn't want it to be a huge jump scare movie. I mean, there's a few jump scares for sure, but we didn't want it to just be jump scare, jump scare, jump scare. We wanted it to be the space is haunted. The space is reading your mind. The space. We wanted to make it about the atmosphere more than about, you know, boo scares.
Mm-hmm. Well, it worked. Very well.
Well, thank you so much, you guys.
Thank
really
you.
Appreciate you guys coming out.
Thank you. One more time for the Dowdle brothers. Thank you guys so much for coming out.
I think the longer you can lead up to it without it getting boring, the better. And there's a natural rhythm to things, like where if you expect it to happen on the beat, you got to do it right before the beat. You know, like you got to sort of set a pace and then break that pace.